In this video, we're deriving a general solution for the simple pendulum. So what we want to get out of this is an expression for theta as a function of time, so the angle as a function of time for the pendulum. Once we have that, we'll take note of what the period of the oscillations is, and then we have a simple example to apply that formula at the end. So I'm going to start by putting in the force of gravity on this thing. And then we notice that this is the angle theta as well. And that allows us to decompose the force of gravity into components. The radial one being mg cosine theta, and the tangential one mg sine of theta. Now that tangential one is the one that we care about because that's what causes a torque on this pendulum and causes it to accelerate in the angular sense. So we're going to apply the rotational equivalent of Newton's second law, that's tau equals I alpha. And my angle is shrinking here, so this is a tricky point about the pendulum. My angle is shrinking, and that means the angular acceleration must be a negative number. In other words, we need to count our torque as negative. So my torque is going to be negative mg sine theta, that's the perpendicular component of force, multiplied by lever arm, which is L. And then I have to use the formula for the moment of inertia of a point mass, which is mr squared, but our distance to the rotation axis in this picture is L, so ml squared, times the angular acceleration, alpha. So alpha is the second time derivative of the angle, and I'm going to isolate that on the left-hand side and write d squared theta dt squared. I'm going to cancel one factor of L while I'm at it, and then the m also cancels. So dividing that L on both sides, I get a negative g over L sine of theta. And now we're looking at a second order differential equation. And the problem with this differential equation is that it's non-linear. So that sine of theta in there, it makes it basically impossible to solve this thing. So the standard trick here is to expand the sine function in a power series. And I'll post a link to the video where I derive how to do this. But as it turns out, the sine function can be expanded like this. So theta minus theta cubed over 3 factorial plus theta to the 5th over 5 factorial minus and so on and so on. This is sometimes called the Maclaurin series. And then the argument is if theta is pretty small, then higher powers of theta are going to be even smaller and therefore negligible. And so we're allowed to truncate this series and say that the sine of theta is approximately equal to theta if theta is quote unquote small. Now, how small does theta have to be for this to be a justifiable approximation? I ran some numbers today and I just wanted to look at 15 degrees or pi over 12. And the sine of pi over 12 is 0.259. And pi over 12 itself, so this is an important point, this formula works if we're talking about theta in radians. Pi over 12 itself is 0.262. And that comes out to about a 1% difference. So with a 15 degree oscillation, we're talking about only a 1% error in our calculation. And if you make theta smaller than that, it gets even more accurate. Okay, replacing sine theta with this truncated power series, now we have a linear second order differential equation, and the solutions to these are guessable. So I'll post a link to where I derived the solutions for the simple harmonic oscillator because I explained in a lot of detail how you get the guessing done. But the bottom line is, if I want a function that I differentiate twice to get back a minus sign and then some constants and then the original function, the general solution is given by sines and cosines with a factor of root g over L in front of the t. And I do have space here to verify that this actually solves the differential equation. I'm trying to show that if I differentiate twice, I get back a negative g over L in front of the original function. So let's differentiate once. And I get negative square root g over L. That's a result of the chain rule. C1 sine root g over L t plus root g over L C2 cosine root g over L t. Now I differentiate again. And the chain rule produces another factor of root g over L. And when I multiply those two factors, I just get g over L. So I have negative g over L, c1 cosine root g over L t minus g over L c2 sine root g over L t. And then I'm trying to find my original function in that. And if I factor out the negative g over L, I do find it. And if I express it as the original theta of t, that proves that this thing obeys the differential equation I was trying to solve. So it is a solution. So there's our general solution for theta as a function of time for a simple pendulum. And you can do problems where you're given initial conditions for the pendulum, like an initial angular position and angular velocity, and then you could find the angle as a function of time for any moment in time. All I'm doing in this video is nailing down what's the period of oscillation. So these periodic functions, the coefficient of t is root g over L. So to get the period of oscillation, I just take 2 pi divided by that coefficient, or 2 pi times the reciprocal of that coefficient. And there's our standard formula for the period of a simple pendulum. Applying this to a quick example, we're asked to get the period of oscillations for a simple pendulum of length 5 meters. So I just plug in 5 for L, 9.8 for G, and crunch the numbers, and I get 4.49 seconds. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.